and fight. We're going to have to lead. Everyone is going to have to lead with kindness, humility, empathy, and not just talk, but action. Action today, action tomorrow. Action until we win. And we will win if we do this together. It's who we are. It's who we always have been. Now let's show them.
Thank you for joining this Biden-Harris campaign event, Hinduism, Climate Change, and Moving Towards a Green America. Please welcome Morli Balaji.
Namaste, Vanakkam. Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for joining our panel, Hindu Americans for Biden and South Asians for Biden. My name is Morli Balaji, the co-chair of Hindu Americans for Biden. This election has enormous stakes, not just for this country, but for this entire planet, particularly saving the planet. That's why we're so thrilled to have our esteemed guests speaking on the critical importance of voting, not just for the direction of this country, but for the direction of this planet in terms of combating climate change and embracing green policies. So without further delay, I'd like to begin this panel on an auspicious note by inviting Dr. Asha Shipman, Hindu spiritual caregiver and renowned Hindu chaplain, to lead us.
Thank you, Morli, and welcome everyone. Conservancy, awe, and respect for the natural world are deeply entwined in our Hindu philosophies and practices, as is evident in our sacred scriptures, epics, poetry, and daily life practices. Upon rising from bed, for example, many Hindus across the world utter a prayer asking forgiveness from Mother Earth for stepping on her as they begin the day. Another example is the Gayatri Mantra, one of the oldest and most potent hymns, which speaks of an all-pervasive holiness that represents water, light, and the quintessence in all things. Certainly, those of you on this call have your own favorite ecologically themed hymns and prayers. Yet the swirl of the modern day, particularly in these past remarkable months, has shifted many people's attention from the natural world to a digital existence, away from recognizing how interconnected and interdependent we are with our precious world. We literally cannot breathe without tending to her well-being, and we don't breathe well at all when we are online. This prayer is for those of you who have not forgotten this vital interconnectedness. These words of blessing may sound familiar as they are drawn from our sacred heritage. They also reflect my own training as an ecologist and anthropologist, though my current work focuses more on spiritual accompaniment and discernment. So sit back, relax, and close your eyes if you prefer. Dharmic defenders of Bhumi Mata, children born of mortal mothers and held by loving hands, may the guardian of the cosmic order shower blessings upon you. May the waters in the sky, the water of rivers, and the water in the well, may all these sacred waters protect you. May these sacred waters wash away any fears, exhaustion, and doubt. May they purify your heart and refresh your efforts. May the life-giving sun, nourisher of all, pour radiance into your body and recharge the flame that burns within the lotus of your heart. Let that divine spark fuel your one-pointed dedication to protecting our beloved pale blue dot of a home, where live all whom we love and know. When weariness takes hold as it will, close the door on the outside world of negotiations, treaties, meetings, and policy making, just for a little while. Remove your shoes and socks and gently press your feet upon the soil, the grass, the leaves, the sands. Let Bhumi Mata caress your souls. Inhale and let prana infuse your body and invigorate each cell. Those daily tidal forces that affect our shorelines affect our inner channels as well. Breathe and align them back into the rhythm of the earth. Hear the songs of ancient ecological knowing, like the songs of women hugging trees in India to defend their forest. Their devotional voices saying, what do the forests bear? Soil, water, and pure air. Soil, water, and pure air sustain the earth and all she bears. Let the whole of humanity hear your songs of Earth democracy. May they be inspired by your work and lend their own voices to the cause of ecological conservation, preservation, and balance. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shantihi.
Thank you for inspiring us, Asha. Now it's my pleasure to introduce our event moderator, Srivani Gunthi, a Hindu American climate activist who is also on the board for Bhumi Global. Take it away, Srivani.
Thank you, Murali. Namaste. I want to thank all of you for attending today's panel. As we know, climate change is very real, and the drastic impact of it are seen and felt daily. We are seeing devastating wildfires on the West Coast and powerful hurricanes in the Gulf. These are only recent examples. The science is clear. We must do something now. Globally, the Hindu community has been an active voice in the goal of creating a more sustainable world through projects like the Temple Green Initiative and Hindu Environmental Week. We've also seen a number of temples take active steps to reducing the amount of waste they produce, and temples such as Tirupati and Andhra Pradesh, India, going solar. In 2015, leaders with the Hindu community came together to write the Hindu Declaration on Climate Change, which was presented during the Paris Climate Talks. This was the first of its kind declaration from the Hindu community that had over 60 major Hindu leaders and organization signatures and received recognition from the United Nations. But what about Hinduism drives us to take action towards climate justice? Our first panelist, Gopal Patel, will share his thoughts on this. Gopal has over 10 years international experience educating and mobilizing Hindu groups for climate action. He also advises international bodies such as the UN and wildlife conservation organizations. Gopal, can you tell us more about Hinduism's teachings on green dharma?
Thank you, Srivani. It's a real pleasure to be here, and thank you to the organizers as well for having me. There's so much to be said when it comes to Hinduism and what it can, how it can inform our environmental activism. I want to really draw upon four key principles that I think are universal across different Hindu traditions. These are, and I'll run through them. The first one is the principle of self-restraint or tapas. In Hinduism, there's this understanding that greed is not good, that we have to rein in our desires to a certain extent, because as Mahatma Gandhi said, there is enough in the world for one man's need, but not for one man's greed. And so we really have to make sure that we have a level of self-restraint, tapas, a level of moderation in our life, in the institutions that we have, in order that we do not overexploit and overuse the natural world. Another teaching from Hinduism is that of cleanliness or purity. And this means that we should have good intentions in the work that we do. We should understand that our motivations have an impact, good and bad, in the world. And as much as our motivations are clear and pure, the work that we do is good and uplifting and wholesome for the planet. The third principle is that of compassion, understanding that there are many people that are suffering in the world, and the earth herself is suffering. And so Hinduism really talks about being a person of compassion, being merciful, helping the vulnerable, the underserved, and the marginalized. And in this current context of the climate crisis, we see that the earth is crying out for help. And we have to be compassionate towards her to help her in this time of her need and in the need of those who are suffering because of climate change. The fourth teaching is one of truthfulness. That's so important in our current age. As you said, Srivani, the science on climate change is real, it's true, and we've known about it since the early 90s. And in the last couple of years, it's become into sharp focus just how much carbon dioxide and the warming planet is disrupting ecosystems. That is truth. And as Hindus, we embrace science, we embrace truth in order to make a positive impact in the world. So these four principles of self-restraint, of purity, compassion, and truthfulness are some of the key principles that underline Hindu environmental action. And I want to highlight, if I can, a short story that talks about those principles in practice. This is a story from the Bhagavad Purana, one of the oldest Hindu texts. It's, I think, 18,000 verses. It's made up of 12 different books. And in the first book of the Bhagavad Purana, there's a story with three characters, a bull, a cow, and a king. Like, stay with me, it gets good. So the bull is walking and it only has one leg. The bull is the representation of religion, of dharma. And the bull has one leg, and that one leg is of truthfulness. The other three legs of self-restraint, purity, and compassion have been broken, have been taken away from the bull. And so therefore the bull is hobbling along on this one leg, the final leg of dharma, which is truthfulness. As the bull is walking, it encounters a cow. And the cow is a representation of the earth, Mother Earth, Bhumi. And the cow is crying, she's distressed, she's distraught, she's broken. And the two of them have a conversation. The bull wants to know why the earth is suffering. Dharma wants to know, Mother Earth, why are you suffering? What has happened to you? Who has done this? Why did they do this? When did they do this? And they have a conversation around the suffering of the earth. Just as this is happening, the king arrives, and the king is King Parikshit, who's very famous in the Mahabharata. And the king wants to know, what's going on? I have a cow that's suffering. I have a bull with one leg. This is a very unusual, unhealthy situation. What's happening? And the three of them have a dialogue, a discourse. And what is revealed in that discourse is that the earth is suffering because unscrupulous people are causing harm on her. People are exploiting her, violating her, taking her for granted. And they're doing so because the legs of dharma have been removed. That the leg of self-restraint, the leg of purity, the leg of compassion are no longer in the world. And that dharma is only standing on this one final leg of truthfulness. And even that is under attack. And so the king, recognizing that dharma needs to be full and healthy in order for the earth to be healthy, works to, in essence, rehabilitate the bull, to rehabilitate dharma, to ensure that the bull is standing on all of its four legs. And in by doing so, making sure the earth is happy and healthy again. And as I was thinking about that story this morning, I was just thinking about our current moment and the real need, as this story highlights, to really have leadership in the world which strives to uphold the legs of dharma. Leadership that tries to uphold honesty, truthfulness, people who have the right intention, and people who are trying to work without ego to help uplift everybody and the planet. And so I wanted to share those offerings as a way to start our conversation here today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Gopal, for those wonderful examples. It was really, really great to hear that. Thank you. So next, I want to introduce Matt McDermott. In addition to his work with the Hindu American Foundation, Matt has written extensively in both popular and academic publications on ecological activism, environmental and climate science, and how Hinduism can help us create more ecologically sustainable societies. He was the lead author on the Hindu Declaration on Climate Change. He has presented talks on these subjects at the last two Parliaments of the World Religions and at several Ivy League universities. Matt, can you share your thoughts on what Gopal shared and your own reflections on how Hinduism better informs us to living greener lives?
Thanks, Shrivani. As you said, I am with the Hindu American Foundation, but I need to give a disclaimer as I start that what I'm talking about today and these views are mine personally. HAF is a 501c3 and we can't endorse political candidates. We do weigh in on policy issues, but we are a genuinely a bipartisan organization in terms of who we work with. So again, I'm talking for myself today. I think Gopal brought up many interesting points. In fact, he sounded like he was cribbing from a talk that I once gave. But today I want to do something that piggybacks off one of the last things he said, which is he mentioned lack of ego or moving beyond ego. So what I want to talk about today is seva. Seva is a word that we often hear within the Hindu tradition. You know, it's selfless service. It's the starting point for action and engagement in the world around us. It begins with our families. And as we develop our awareness, our circle of compassion extends outward to our neighbors, our local communities, regions, nations. And eventually, if we've practiced long enough and we manage to put ourselves in the right headspace, all the beings that share the planet, and if you want to go even farther, although we have no evidence of it conclusively, all of the beings in the universe, the manifest universe around us. Most of the time when we talk about Seva, we're thinking about volunteering in some way, whether it's at a temple, a charitable organization, or event. But what I want to put to you today is that with the right frame of mind, everything you do can be a practice of Seva. Everything you can do to live a more ecologically aware life can be thought of Seva, of being of service to creating a more vibrant planet. With this attitude of being to service to something greater than ourselves, Seva is both the actions we take and the actions we don't take. Sometimes what we don't do can be as powerful as what we do do. So when is action Seva, environmentally speaking? When are we practicing Seva? I say practice specifically because practice implies failure. We're never going, none of us are going to be perfect at everything we do when it comes to reducing our environmental impact. Clearly, as a society, both in the US and around the world, by many measures, we're failing. But the important thing that we do is that we keep practicing and keep trying and keep trying to do better. So again, when are we practicing Seva? It's what we eat and what we don't eat. It's where our power comes from, and it's trying to use less of it. It's how we get around and how often we do it. It's the clothes we buy and how many we don't. It's how many personal possessions we have. Asking ourselves the difficult questions of what truly is necessary to live a good life. That's a question that all of us have to answer, and there are going to be many, many, many different versions of that. It's planting a garden. It's growing your own food if you can. It's cleaning up the beach and make sure that you don't litter. It's cleaning up outside your house in the street and keeping things tidy. It's also about taking to the streets to make sure our elected representatives take these issues seriously. It's pressuring them to listen to scientists and other experts on this subject and creating policies that have a chance of solving these issues. It's voting for these candidates and supporting them. It's making sure that while we're taking these actions, we don't overlook the fact that our economic and political systems, both in the US and globally, also need to change. It's a false choice to say that either we must change as individuals and families, or that we must change our economic and political systems to be more ecologically friendly. It's both. Both are important and necessary. Each side plays into one another and encourages certain behaviors and constraining others. To bring this back to Hinduism, one of the most beautiful facets of this tradition to me is its individualized nature when it comes to how we approach the divine. Truth is one, God is one, but the wise call this by different names, paraphrasing. Applying this, we can embrace diverse paths to Seva and to how we protect nature. There are room for many approaches. Different individuals and communities have different needs, tendencies, and preferences. Not everyone is attracted to in the streets activism, but if you are, good. Not everyone is attracted to running for political office, but if you are, good. Not everyone will become vegan, but if you change your diet and start eating more plants and less meat, that's unequivocally a great thing for the planet. Not everyone is going to be a minimalist, but if you start asking yourself, do I truly need this thing before buying it and acting on it, that's good. Not everyone lives someplace that can walk or bike everywhere, and certainly not everyone has good public transportation around. But you can get the most efficient, fuel-efficient car that you can afford, or even better yet, electric. Not everyone can install solar panels on their house. I'm here in an apartment building and I can't do anything about that. But we all can look into clean power programs with our utility company. The point is, it sounds like I wasn't really talking about Hinduism, but all of those things can be seen as Seva, can be seen of being of service to the divine, can be seen of service to nature, which those two things to me are pretty much the same thing. The point is, we must all do our part when it comes to nature, our environment, ecological sustainability, whatever you want to call it. What this looks like will be different for each person, and that too is a good thing. Embracing this as a kind of Seva gives these actions a depth of meaning that makes them all easier. It gives us the emotional and spiritual sustenance to keep going with them, even in the face of setbacks, which the last 4 years have entirely been tragically so. We all now have a chance to step up and change the course of this nation and ultimately all nations. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Matt. And I really appreciate how you make it tangible. One thing that can be really hard for individuals is sometimes you feel as though your climate activism is a struggle. And it's a really important reminder that it's small steps that we can take on a day-to-day basis. And it happens where you trip up every now and then, but it's okay because your intent and saliva towards the higher makes a big difference. So thank you so much for sharing those reflections, Matt. So now that we understand the spiritual underpinnings of climate activism, what work is being done on the ground? Our next panelist is Harini Krishnan. Harini is a co-California State Director for South Asians for Biden and an elected delegate at the 2020 Democratic National Convention, who is part of the team that helped put together the first Hindu delegates meeting at the DNC. Harini, can you share your thoughts on why the Biden-Harris ticket is so important and the grassroots community efforts?
Yes, first of all, I want to thank Dr. Murali Balaji and Vaibhav Jain for inviting me to be a part of this panel. I actually want to start with a shlokam that is actually very relevant to the discussion that we're having. Om Purnamadah Purnamidham Purnat Purnam Udhachyate Purnasya Purnam Adhaya Purnam Yeva Vasishyate. This shlokam essentially says, Om, that outer world is Purna, which is full with divine consciousness. This inner world is also Purna, full with divine consciousness. From Purna is manifested Purna. From the fullness of divine consciousness, the world is manifested. Taking Purna from Purna, Purna indeed remains Om, peace, peace, peace. As Matt said very beautifully, the roots of ecology lie in Sanatana Dharma or Hinduism, and no other religion pays as much attention to the environment and environmental ethics and to the understanding of the role and value of nature, because Hinduism is inherently an ecological religion or path of life or faith. It views the earth as our mother and advocates that it should not be exploited. And a loss of this understanding that earth is our mother has resulted in exploitation of the earth and its resources. And centuries ago, the Shruti, or, you know, through Vedas and Upanishads and Smriti, Ramayana, Mahabharata, Puranas, instructed us that animals and plants found in the land of Bharata are sacred, that like humans, our fellow creatures, including plants, have consciousness, and therefore all aspects of nature are to be revered. And this understanding, care, and reverence towards the environment is common to all spiritual systems, whether it's Hinduism, Indic spiritual systems, whether it's Hinduism, Buddhism, or Jainism. And why is it relevant? This is relevant because we are in the most consequential election of our lifetime. Our planet, our environmental crisis demands a response. The world is grappling to find solutions to multiple crises of the environment. And for ecology to be truly saved and revived, we have to return to the meanings and practices that infuse sacredness and reverence towards nature, as in Hindu traditions, and reawaken our relationship with nature and view our faith system and ecology as intertwined. And for Hindus, the environment is the dharmic way of life and hence a righteous duty that all humans are obliged to perform. And this is an understanding that is very much a part of VP Biden and Senator Kamala Harris's policy. They understand, they have a deep respect for the environment as outlined by the Biden-Harris climate plan. And it is imperative on every one of us Hindu Americans to act in this moment. because our fundamental spiritual way of life dictates that we act, that we do everything in our power to protect our Matrubhumi, that we come together as a community to invest in our future and to invest in our environment and to invest in our larger community. So what can we do? There's so much we can do. We can, we're in the middle of a global pandemic. There are certain limitations that we have in terms of canvassing. What we can do is join phone banks. Calling voters is the most effective way to connect with them and to tell them the importance of this election, which will dictate the future of the world as we know it, from an environmental ecological perspective. So join our phone banks, join our text banks. Another way is for you to have those fundamental conversations with your friends and family. Every one of us has a circle, has a large circle of friends and family that we can connect with, and we can convey the importance of participating. It is imperative on us to no longer be in the sidelines. We have to be active participants and change the narrative of the future for our children and our grandchildren. So with that, I am truly delighted to invite you to a phone bank that is happening right after this amazing event that is hosted by South Asians for Biden. It's a phone bank to South Asian voters in Texas. We invite every one of you to join us. We will drop the mobilize link in the chat, and we hope you will join us. We also have phone banks into other battleground states, and every weekend. And we hope you will take in an hour or two. We hope you will continue talking to your friends and family about voting, exercising their right to vote, about talking to them, and having those hard conversations. And telling them that our Sanatana Dharma, at the core of our Sanatana Dharma, is service to humanity and service to our Matrubhumi and our planet and our environment. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Harini. That was beautiful. And thank you for sharing scriptural and shlokams to help tie in. I think that allows all of us to, again, tie it back to something that is so personal and tangible and found within Hinduism. So thank you for that. So it's important that we understand what's being done on the grassroots level, but as we've all been seeing the past few years, it's imperative we see something being done at a larger scale and have an administration with a plan to address climate change at a larger scale. Our next panelist is Mala Adiga, Senior Policy Advisor for Biden for President. She was formerly the Deputy Assistant Secretary of State for Academic Programs in the Obama-Biden administration, responsible for overseeing a wide range of international educational programs, including the Fulbright and Gilman programs. Previously, she served in the Secretary of State's Office of Global Women's Issues as Chief of Staff and Senior Advisor to the Ambassador at Large. Mala, can you tell us more about the Biden-Harris plan for addressing climate change?
Yes, thank you very much, Shravani. Hello, everyone. As a Hindu American working on the Biden campaign, it's a pleasure to join you all for this conversation. As Shravani mentioned, I'd like to take a few minutes to discuss Vice President Biden and Senator Harris's plan to tackle our global climate crisis. Joe Biden has been a champion of addressing climate change for a long time. In 1986, he introduced one of the first ever climate bills in Congress. He understands that climate change poses a threat to our communities. We see the devastating impacts of climate change everywhere, and billions of dollars of damage in the loss of lives and livelihoods, and in the destruction in big cities, small towns, on the coast, and in farmlands across the country. It will take our collective action to address this grave challenge. Vice President Biden knows that we need a president who respects science when addressing climate change. He also knows that we have to take bold action, which is why he has proposed a bold plan. His plan takes into account that we have to meet the threat of the climate crisis while also recovering from the economic challenges we're facing. This means creating an equitable, clean energy future while also creating millions of good-paying jobs. This means a United States that has modernized water, transportation, and energy infrastructure that is resilient and sustainable. His plan calls for ensuring that the United States achieves a 100% clean energy economy and reaches net zero emissions across the US economy no later than 2050. On his first day as president, he will sign a number of executive orders to make historic progress on reducing greenhouse gas emissions and setting pollution limits on companies, as well as protecting our federal lands and our biodiversity. In addition, he will call upon Congress to enact legislation in his first year in office. He will focus on research and development on clean energy, clean transportation, and clean materials so that we invent, make, and export these innovative technologies. This means we need scientists at national labs, at land-grant universities, and at minority-serving educational institutions to improve and innovate these technologies. We need engineers to design them and workers to manufacture and install them. He'll invest in making homes and buildings more energy efficient and in generating clean American-made electricity for families and businesses. This will help us create millions of jobs and meet the threat of climate change. And he will invest in conservation by creating a civilian climate corps, which will put a new diverse generation of Americans to work conserving our public lands and mitigating climate change. Vice President Biden and Senator Harris also understand that any sound energy and environmental policy must also recognize that communities of color and low-income communities have faced disproportionate harm from climate change and from contaminants in their environment. Therefore, addressing environmental justice is a key aspect of their climate plan. They believe every person has a right to breathe clean air and drink clean water. That's why they will improve air quality, ensure that clean, safe drinking water is available in all of our communities, and hold accountable those polluters who disproportionately harm communities of color and low-income communities. And Vice President Biden is also going to make the United States a global leader again on this issue, rejoining the Paris Agreement and rallying the rest of the world. He will not only recommit the United States to the Paris Agreement, but he will also lead an effort to get every major country to ramp up the ambition of their domestic climate targets. I just want to end with the Vice President's words. As he said when discussing his climate change plan, we can commit to doing this together because we know that climate change is the existential challenge that will define our future as a country for our children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. So thank you for giving me the opportunity to talk with you all about the Biden-Harris plan on climate change. But more importantly, I want to thank you all for your support for and your work on this campaign. And as a member of this community, I am extra proud and grateful for all that you do. And now I'll pass it back to Shravani.
Thank you so much, Mala. It's really wonderful to hear about a plan that embraces the science, recognizes the disproportionate impact on communities of color and those who are marginalized, and really aims to get us back on track to addressing the climate crisis. Our last panelist is Sri Kulkarni, Democratic nominee for Texas's 22nd Congressional District. Sri is a lifelong public servant and national security expert who has spent his career overseas working to protect Americans here at home. From Jerusalem to Iraq to Russia, Sri served in some of the toughest places in the world, representing the interests of the United States and reducing conflict around the globe. Sri will be the first Asian American ever elected to the US Congress in the history of Texas. His campaign is the first in the country to run in 27 languages. You can see more in the link that we will share in the chat. Sri, can you share your own professional experience, especially in the climate work area?
Absolutely, and first of all, it's an honor to be here today with all of you. I think we all know that our community is taking on a greater and greater role in civics, and especially in our elections this year in 2020. Back in 2018, when I first ran for Congress, this was kind of a pipe dream. I've been overseas serving under Republican and Democratic administrations as a Foreign Service officer for over 14 years. And when I resigned to come home, because of all the things that I'd seen happen over the last few years, the demonization of immigrants in particular, we decided to run the most inclusive campaign ever here as an antidote to all of that fear and division. So you alluded to it just now in the introduction. We're the first campaign running in 27 different languages. And when we first started, we were told, don't bother with your community. Don't bother with Asian Americans because they don't vote. And the easiest way to lose an election is to talk to people that don't vote. And we said the easiest way to never get change is to keep doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. I had never had someone who looked like me, someone with my name or my faith or my background to look up to growing up here in Texas. And it's hard to build that political base. But based on my experience overseas, speaking six languages myself, we started to recruit people from every one of the major communities. So we have a Telugu group, a Gujarati group, a Malayali group, a Kannada group, a Bengali group, in addition to all of our other groups, such as Chinese, Vietnamese, Arabic, Igbo, Spanish, Yoruba. And the result of that was that we started to pull people out from the community. We've always had intellectual capital in this country. We participate in science, and we're engineers, we're doctors. We've had financial capital. We've created great businesses here, but we've never really had political capital in our community. And I think at this moment in particular, we need it more than ever. Because of the challenges that we see, and that goes from gun violence. There's a Hindu concept of ahimsa that is needed so strongly here. We had a mass shooting right outside of our district, and it's something that people in our community care very deeply about. It obviously goes for the pandemic. We have so many people who are on the front lines in the Texas Medical Center, for example, who are treating people every day and making sure that we do simple things like wearing masks to prevent the spread of infection. And then, of course, climate change, which is the global challenge of our time. And it's something that we and our community and our values have a lot to say about and a lot to contribute to this discussion, because we value preserving the earth. And we know that this is not something that affects just one community, affects all of us. And so in our campaign, for example, in Texas, sometimes people try to frame this as an issue of, is it jobs or is it protecting the environment? And we say we can do both, because we have the best and the brightest minds here. That's the beauty of America, that we attract talent from all over the world, including from India, who come here. They're highly skilled. We have the ability to use our scientific know-how and create those jobs of the 21st century here. Texas is already the leader in oil and gas. We're also the leader in wind in the country. Largest wind producing state in America. We should be the leader in solar. That means expanding into new technologies on storage capacity, for example. It means tying the east and the western grid of the United States together with a grid that's basically for Texas called ERCOT. It means using our skills, for example, drilling. It's not a matter of drilling or not drilling, but we can drill deeper and get geothermal energy out of the ground. All of these things are things that I think Texas has a lot to say and a lot to contribute to the discussion about creating that renewable economy, creating the jobs of the future. And I think Vice President Biden is the right person to do that because of his long experience working in the legislative branch and bringing people together. That's how we need to reframe this, not as us versus them, but how are all of us in this challenge together? Because we see it again and again. Here in Houston, I've lived through 500-year flood event after 500-year flood event. I've lost my car to flooding. My brother and sister almost lost their lives having to jump out of their windows as floodwater started pouring in, and we had to sleep on a stranger's floor as floodwater was rising around Houston. And we see it happening again and again. I've talked to so many families who have been completely wiped out. And having multiple 500-year flood events doesn't mean that we're safe for 1,500 years. It means that we as a community need to recognize these challenges. And it's the same thing in California right now. I've had two friends whose entire homes have been wiped out completely, lost everything they had in fires just in this past week. We know that climate change is not a Chinese hoax, as Vice President Biden's opponent, the current president, has said before. We know that we can rise to this challenge together. And I think that our community, especially in places like Texas, where we are one of the fastest growing communities. Asian Americans are the fastest growing community in Texas. We have a lot to say if we express our voice, if we care about belief in science. If we care about our children, our families, especially future generations, and what we are passing on to them, then we have to make that known at the ballot box. And so I'm so proud that Vice President Biden is going to be our future president. And I'm also proud that Senator Harris is going to be our future vice president, because the inspiration that we see for this entire younger generation here, I've seen it throughout my campaign of young people coming up and saying, we can actually be whatever we want to be. Now, every family here, every father, every mother, and especially every son, and especially every daughter knows that they can grow up to be whatever they want in the United States of America, having the first ever Asian American, the first ever person of Indian origin elected to vice president in our history. That's something that we should all be proud of. And I see the energy, the excitement that I've never seen it at this level before, especially here in Texas where I've grown up. So I'm just so proud of my community, what we are all doing together, bringing our values when it's most needed in our country, and showing that we are fully American, that we don't have to choose between being a Hindu and being an American, because we are both. And those values are needed right now more than ever. So if anybody wants to help participate in the most historic election of our lifetimes, please join us at this phone bank right after this event at 2 p.m. Eastern time. And I think they're putting a link in the side. And if you want to know more about what we're doing, campaigning in 27 languages, if you speak Gujarati or Telugu or Kannada or Marathi, and one of these languages, want to help get out more people from our community, please also go visit our website and learn about what we're doing. So thank you all so much for everything you're doing and helping us in this most important, the most historic election of our lifetimes, and making sure that we can be the difference, because we should. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sri. And it's really wonderful to hear how your campaign is reaching out to so many different communities. And the 27 languages is really inspirational, because I think it really highlights the diversity that is America. We are a nation of immigrants. We always must remember that. And, you know, that level of accessibility really can drive change. And I'm really excited to see what it does in the future. So thank you so much. So now I just wanted to transition towards some questions for our panelists and get your thoughts on what are some takeaways everyone who's attending today's panel can go with. So my first question for all of you are, what are some small steps we can take today to help reduce our carbon footprint and to make a big difference in the future? Whoever would like to go first.
I guess I'll go first, as I was tasked with laying out the practical things. Top three things. I would say eat less meat at best, eat no meat better. Check where your power is coming from. Everybody, I think, in the United States has the ability to sign up for a clean power program with their utility, which means that though you don't have solar panels on your house, and yes, all the electricity gets mixed into a grid, the money you are paying, which is a tiny bit more than you will be ordinarily be paying, will go to support clean power projects such as wind power. Most of them are wind power. Some of them are geothermal, some of them are solar, but most of those tend to be wind power. The third thing is I would say, figure out how to get around in a more eco-friendly way. That's not always possible, particularly in states like Texas, where the distances are vast. But that is a big thing that you can do. So buy the most fuel-efficient car that you can, or even better yet, buy an electric car. Electric cars are a wonderful thing if you haven't actually driven one. Those are the top three things. Transportation and diet account for a huge part of our emissions. And if we all do our part to reduce those and do what we can, knowing that we will never have a perfect solution to that until the whole system changes, you're doing a lot.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so I would like to echo what Matt said. I would just add one other thing on there, food waste. Food waste is actually a big problem in our society. Sorry, the reason I say that is because I go by the drawdown list. If anybody has seen that, they've tried to estimate, try to take the politics out of climate change, because a lot of the arguments that we have aren't about the evidence, they aren't about the science, they're just about which side of the aisle you're on, and that doesn't really get us anywhere. And so when I talk to people, especially across the aisle, about climate change, I say let's look at a table of evidence, and the drawdown list is the best that I've seen of that. They try to estimate the gigatons of carbon that will be removed from the atmosphere over the next 30 years from each one of these interventions, and you can just look on it and sort the list yourself. But the number one thing that they have currently on the list is actually food waste. If we reduce food waste, and also if we go to plant-rich diets, those are two of the biggest things that we can do to reduce gigatons of carbon out of the atmosphere over the next 30 years. But there's also other things that we don't talk about as often, such as refrigerant management, proper land use, proper education and health, reproductive health access. All of these things have an impact on climate change, and I would prefer to talk about them in terms of numbers and science and evidence rather than which side of the political spectrum we're on.
Absolutely, that's 100% true. Go ahead, Gopal.
Yeah, just echoing what Sri said, he said that we don't talk about certain things more, and I think that's one thing we can do, just talk about climate change, talk about biodiversity loss. I think if we normalize the conversation, then it's easier to move into action. I think all of us struggle to remember the last time we had a conversation about climate change with our parents, grandparents, or friends, or siblings. So I think just talking about it just creates a safe space where we, because first the talk needs to be there before the action is, right? First, we need to be aware of the issues. So just talking about it is a first step to moving into all the great things Matt and Sri just outlined.
Absolutely. So then jumping off of that, Gopal, you mentioned having conversations, and this is for all of you, but as we know, political conversations, getting involved, especially with our parents, relatives, it can be a little sticky. So what are your thoughts and recommendations on how we broach these subject matters? Because again, I don't think it's lost on any of us here, but this election is critical and it's important that we all vote. So what would your recommendations be in terms of broaching those types of conversations?
If I can go first, I would start, and I generally start with, what are the needs, interests, and concerns of the person I'm speaking with, right? So if I'm speaking with a college student, I know their concerns are going to be around the long-term health and well-being of the planet. If I'm speaking to an older person, their concerns are going to be maybe a bit more economics and financial, right? So we have to find out what the pressure points are for the people we're talking to about to get them interested. For example, if they're really concerned about wildlife, we can talk about how the Ganges and the Yamuna in India are considered dead rivers, that no life can exist in those rivers anymore. So we really need to find out what people are interested in to start the conversation. To start the conversation where we're interested, oftentimes we close down the conversation immediately, but to start where they're interested from, that then allows us to open that space for dialogue and then interaction.
You go, Paul. Sri?
Sure. So I'd also like to echo what Gopal said. I will say this, with young people, for example, when I talk to them about politics, a lot of them, they don't feel, even if they care about climate change as an issue, climate change or gun violence or racial equality, they don't always feel so attracted towards one of the political parties. They definitely don't feel that they're Democrats. And I tell them, that's okay. You don't have to be a Democrat to come out and vote. In fact, if you want to tear down the entire system, which is what a lot of people who are 18 to 25 year old, 25 want to do, I tell them the best way to do that is to just get 10 of your friends to show up on election day. And the reason for that is that both the Republican Party and the Democratic Party, neither of their models account for you showing up. They expect you to stay home. And so if you actually want climate change to be on the agenda, if you want gun violence to be on the agenda or racial equality or any of the things that you are fighting for right now, you can tear down the system literally just by getting your friends to show up in more massive numbers than we've ever seen before, because your population is just that large. And that's usually very attractive to young people. If I'm talking to some of my elders, my parents' generation, I will try to reframe things in terms of this kind of things that we're talking about today. I will talk about dharma. I will talk about ahimsa, and I'll talk about our values, the addition that we bring to this society. When you see yoga across America, that's part of our culture that has been brought here. But our culture also involves respect for nonviolence. Our culture involves respect for health, respecting your elders who are right now at risk for coronavirus. But it also means preserving the earth for future generations and that respect for nature that is so fundamental to our culture and our values. I think that's something that we talk about. And then again, if people care a lot, a lot of my family members, for example, they look back to India all the time, and they care about what's going on in India. And you talk about the things that we are doing together. We talk about like trade deals, we talk about immigration, but we can talk about the Paris Climate Agreement that we negotiated that India was part of. And that kind of global cooperation, the areas that we have to partner on global challenges. I think that that appeals to a lot of people when you talk about all of the different things that Vice President Biden has done in the previous administration. When you talk about the support for India, you talk about bringing in highly skilled immigrants here and the contrast with the current administration. All of those things, I think, are ways to get around these normal political debates. But at the end of the day, it's really about telling human stories, because you connect to people through the heart, not through the head. And if you can tell a human story about what you've experienced, that's why when I talk about climate change, I talk about how it hit my family and the families that that I've seen here. That's the way that you change people. I've never changed someone's mind by showing them a chart.
Thank you. Thank you for that. So before we begin to wrap up, I just want to invite you guys, if there are any last thoughts that you had that you wanted to share with everyone. Gonna take that as a no. Well, thank you everyone so much for attending this panel on Hinduism, climate change, and moving towards a green America. I want to thank all of our panelists for taking the time to be here today and for sharing their wonderful insights on how we as Hindu Americans can make a difference. Have a great rest of your day, everyone, and don't forget to vote on November 3rd. Back to you, Murali.
Thank you so much, Srivani, to Gopal, to Matt, Asha, of course, for leading us off, Harini, Sri, and Mala. And this conversation is essential, but it's more than just the conversation, it's the action. As all of our panelists have said, we can actually do so much to help save our planet. We are Hindu Americans, we're guided by our scriptures, but it's time to put our scriptures into action. And so the first thing we need to do is go and vote. Register to vote if you haven't done so already. Vote early. I voted yesterday. I took my eight-month-old son with me. I promise you, you will feel a lot better once you've cast that ballot. So please vote. Our community's voice is only as loud as our participation. So please vote. Make sure you support the Biden-Harris ticket. Make sure you support down ballot candidates who are fighting for Hindu Americans and fighting to save our planet, like Sri Preston Kulkarni. And make sure that you join us for the phone bank that starts in just a few minutes, that's in our chat link. Thank you, everyone. Namaste, and have a wonderful rest of your day.